it is time again to ask ourselves another question regarding Intel's new 10th gen CPUs. Does Intel maybe with today's CPU stand a chance against Ryzen? Yes, I'm slowly moving down the ladder of Intel processors. In today's spotlight, they are for the Intel Core i5-10400. As it's the case with the i5-10600K, which I've recently reviewed, we get 6 cores and 12 threads here too. The 10600K manages to impress with its amazing gaming performance, but how is that looking with this smaller 10400? Is there even a significant decrease in gaming performance noticeable, or could this cheaper, more affordable i5 Comet Lake CPU end up being one of the most attractive gaming CPUs out there right now, at least if you tend to care about pricing, that is? And what about AMD? How does the competition fare against that? Maybe I should tell you about the price of the 10400 first of all. Right now we are talking of about 180 to 200 US dollars, basically depending on the availability as always. Now, is this processor any good, or should you pick up something else instead? What definitely differs fundamentally from the other K models, i5-10600K, 10700K and 10900K, is the fact that a stock cooler is included here by Intel. I mean, who isn't familiar with that aesthetically pleasing, probably one of the best looking coolers on the market? That one is so hot, the majority of its aluminum heatsink melted away. So I guess it's safe to say the i5-10400, in terms of temperatures, won't cause any issues if Intel thinks this measly thing will do the job for cooling. Oh yeah, quick shout out and thank you goes out to Equipper once again for the quick delivery of these CPUs at fairly reasonable prices. This allowed me to get started and finish my reviews much sooner than usual, as you may or may not have noticed. Three specific CPUs we'll be comparing against each other today, namely the i5-10400, the 10600K and AMD's Ryzen 5 3600. All of them are 6 cores with 12 threads respectively. Except for today's 10400, as the lack of the K at the end already suggests, the other two in theory can still be overclocked. The 10400 unfortunately comes with a locked multiplier, something I and many of you find to be a bit of a bummer and even slightly annoying. Especially since AMD for years, even on their lower tier models, allows cranking up that multiplier. The main differences, on paper at least, between the 10400 and the more expensive 10600K, therefore, is the fact that the 10600K features a fully unlocked multiplier, a much higher clock speed, especially a noticeably higher base clock, and also sports a higher TDP. The 65 watts in the 10400 Intel is stating mean a lot, we most likely won't have to criticize temperatures. Other than that, everything else more or less remains the same, even the amount of cache. Well, and in theory, the integrated graphics unit clocks up to 100 MHz lower on the 10400, which however, I will not be testing, since most of you simply don't seem to care, and honestly, I'm with you there. Although in theory, it makes hardly any sense to pair a non-K processor with a Z490 motherboard, I'm doing it anyway, since I didn't want to get another board with a more suitable H470 or B460 chipset. Unlike many assume, I am not rich and don't have a bunch of money to spend, which is why I'll reuse my ASRock Z490 Extreme 4 motherboard. But a set B460 or H470 certainly would make more sense. Overclocking is not officially supported by Intel on those two chipsets, even though certain motherboard manufacturers make an exception by using some tricks, so to speak. As for cooling, it makes sense to include the included stock cooler, but for my main testing, I'll stick to my Deepcool Castle 240EX all-in-one liquid cooler to keep everything as consistent as possible. If I put 100% load onto those 6 cores, the 10400 clocks at exactly 4 GHz. Unfortunately though, cannot maintain it constantly, which came to me as a big surprise. Things seemed to look better with the 10600K, and now all of a sudden, we get to see a step back again? Intel's policy, or rather strategy, sure can be strange sometimes. The funny thing is, the 10400 cannot even finish a whole Cinebench run before it downclocks itself 100 MHz. But can the promised max turbo clock of 4.3 GHz be achieved on this, quote, low power CPU, end quote? No, unfortunately not. Instead of the 4.3 GHz, my eyes only got to see 4.1 GHz. Well, yeah, it's no catastrophe, and it doesn't really affect performance that much, but it sure is a bit of a mystery. I doubt it's the motherboard's VRM, as some people suggested. And I don't want to start any drama here. You know, I didn't jump on the whining bandwagon last year when it came to those Ryzen 3000 boost clocks, when we experienced similar issues. This does not mean that I agree with what Intel and or AMD do, however. I'm pretty sure BIOS updates will fix a lot of the issues, and I'm certain not all motherboards act the same way or even are affected. What does bother me more though is the fact that this quote new Intel platform end quote, as opposed to AMD's latest platform, does not come with the latest and greatest features such as PCIe 4.0. Yeah, sure, in combination with a $180 CPU, PCIe 4.0 may not make a whole lot of sense, since I doubt someone spending under $200 on a CPU is going for one of those expensive superfast NVMe SSDs anyway. Still, it's something I wanted to let you guys know, especially those that are new here on my channel. So now let's get those test results in, as always with the RTX 2080 Ti graphics card to somewhat avoid GPU bottlenecks. Enjoy! Okay, I'll try to keep this short and sweet. The i5-10400 sure is an impressive little thing, even at a price scratching the $200 mark. When it comes to gaming performance, the 10400 as opposed to the more expensive i5-10600K can still very much impress. Here and there we get a slightly lower frame rate with the 10400, but honestly, in most game titles, the 10400 and 10600K are somewhat on par. So if you're only gaming, even though the 10600K did extraordinarily well there, in my opinion, today's 10400 appears to be an even better deal. Things of course start to look different in heavily multi-threaded applications. Now I don't want to say there are worlds in between those two i5 models, but the 10400 sure offers noticeably less raw performance. So no longer the ideal CPU if you like to render or do streaming besides gaming. This is what AMD does a lot better. Right now at least the i5-10400 goes for about $180 to $200. The Ryzen 5 3600 you often get for even less, often for around $180. Nonetheless, the Ryzen 5 3600 beats the i5-10400 in most of the multi-core aspects, no doubt. The 3600 by AMD does however drop behind significantly in, surprise, gaming. with high frame rates, in my opinion, often negligible, especially given most of you with a $180 CPU happen to be within the GPU limit, since an RTX 2080 Ti may turn out to be a little bit too pricey, but still, in theory, the 10400 is capable of delivering the higher number of FPS than what the Ryzen 3600 is capable of. Despite Intel's dated CPU architecture, they still somewhat managed to successfully, especially with those mid to lower end models, achieve a decent power consumption and surprisingly good temperatures. So I really can't complain here, not even when using the stock cooler, well, except for the fact the stock cooler is fairly annoying. So here I clearly have to say, if you're choosing between the i5-10400 and the Ryzen 5 3600, it's not the easiest choice to make. Only for gaming, no questions asked, the 10400 takes the lead. If you, however, want to do more besides gaming, like rendering, video editing, maybe even a little bit of streaming, an AMD processor will suit you better most of the time. And then again, we need to keep in mind the gaps turn out to be bigger since an RTX 2080 Ti was used for testing. With a mid-range graphics card, something you would usually pair an i5-10400 or Ryzen 5 3600 with, we would not see that significant of a difference. The extra gaming speed of the 10400 would probably go somewhat unnoticed, since you're within the GPU's limits. But you can look at this from different perspectives. But I personally would probably, once again, pick the AMD Ryzen 5 3600. And yeah, thanks a lot for watching, and I guess you'll hear from me again in the next video.